Should I start?
You will have the timer. What is ocular hypertension? The definition is intraocular pressure more than 21, no detectable visual field loss, and no detectable optic disc or nerve fiber layer damage, open angles, and there is no ocular or systemic cause for the increased intraocular pressure. With this introduction, I welcome the few delegates who are present here to our breakfast course, Tips and Algorithms for Ocular Hypertension. It's one aspect of glaucoma where there's a dilemma whether to treat or observe. Treatment condemns the patient to a lifetime of sometimes unnecessary treatment, and not treating can cause progression and irreversible loss, especially if the patients don't follow up. Since patients are our best teachers, Dr. Tanuja Kate, Senior Consultant, Rajas Eye and Retina Research Center, Indore, and I, Dr. Preeti Kamdar from Dr. Kamdar's Clinic and Jashim Eye Institute, Mumbai, the coordinators for this breakfast course, will be presenting an algorithm for ocular hypertension with discussion on actual cases, and our panelists are Dr. Sunita Dubey, Head of Glaucoma Services, Dr. Shroff's Charity Hospital, New Delhi, and Dr. Shalini Mohan, Associate Professor and Officer in Charge, Glaucoma, GSVM Medical College, Kanpur. Now, it's what to do with these patients. These are the points we are going to address in this session. How often should they be examined? Is preventive treatment effective? And who should be treated? The OAT study provided us with the most of the guidelines for managing patients with ocular hypertension. Based on those guidelines, we present our algorithm for managing ocular hypertension, and this is an overview. As we discuss each case, we'll be presenting this algorithm again and just seeing in which area our patient fits in. So starting with the first case, it was a 14-year-old girl, myope of about minus 4. She came for refraction and her vision was 6 by 6 N5 with refraction. The intraocular pressure on the first visit was 26 and 28. Of course, when I saw this, I did the CCT, which was 555 and 550 microns. This was her disc of the right eye, and this was her disc of the left eye, which is absolutely healthy. These are her fields, which are normal. And this is the left eye field, which is normal. This is the OCT. The OCT is, because it's a patient who's under 18, you will not have any normative database to guide you, but you will realize that this nerve fiber layer is very, very healthy. So now here we have a patient who has high pressure, is young, has a family history of glaucoma. So my, and this is mother and maternal grandfather suffer from glaucoma, and they are documented. It's not some hearsay. Mother has tubular vision in one eye, and maternal grandfather has lost vision in one eye because of glaucoma. So what should we do? On one reading, should I start treatment? Should I observe? Should I recheck IOP? If yes, then how often? So these are the questions which we would like our panelists to address. So can we start? How do we, this is the patient who's come, how do we manage?
So this is a young girl, like 14-year-old, and her pressures are 26 and 28. Okay, so the pressures are pretty on the higher side, and she has a strong family history. Although, like, you can't do the investigations like OCT and all in this particular girl.
I did this.
You did, normative. But normative data, but you can, you know can about the RNFL thickness. So the investigations were within normal limits in her. But then her pressures were on the higher side, and she has a strong family history of glaucoma. And maternal, like mother and maternal.
Yeah, documented.
Documented. And what about the central corneal thickness?
It is 555 and 560 microns.
Yeah, so corneal thickness still okay.
Yes.
But looking at the strong family history and the pressures on also on the higher side, first I would like to do a diurnal in this particular patient, so as to know about the maximum pressure, how much it is, because it is just a snapshot, like one reading, 26, 28, maybe her pressure may be higher in the morning, higher than this. So in this particular girl, I may like to start treatment.
You will start. So yeah. First you'll do a diurnal.
Yeah, I'll do a diurnal. Yeah.
So on one single reading, you will not start treatment. So basically what I want to highlight is that whatever the compulsions, one single pressure is not enough to label a patient as having glaucoma. You have to recheck the IOP. Dr. Dubey feels she would do a diurnal.
Yeah.
Shalini, would you differ in this?
Can we see the disc photograph again?
Yes, I will show you.
Because in such patients, when we cannot compare the RNFL thickness because of absence of normative data, and the fields are also normal, I would like to focus more on the disc.
Yeah, so the disc like is perfectly
Here we can see cup is definitely larger, although the ISNT is maintained in this particular girl. And I can't see any RNFL defect also.
Beautiful, nice RNFL.
Exactly. So it looks a healthy disc. So in such patients, when discs are healthy, I would like to keep her under close follow-up. Obviously, we'll go for Dahlner variation. The other eye is also symmetrical cupping is there. And because she is myope, we expect the disc to be on the larger side. So my take would be that because she is having such a strong family history, we should keep her under close follow-up. And because she is just 14 years of age, starting treatment might actually give her a bit of mental trauma also. So we will keep her under strict follow-up, and we will repeat the disc photograph every 4 monthly, so that in case we get any of the signs of progression of there is any asymmetry in the disc, then we will start treatment.
Tanuja, you have anything different to say?
Dr. Shalini, since the pressures are it's not less than 25, it's 26, 28 you said,
yes,
na?
26 and
so
28.
In my opinion also, I would like to start with treatment because she has a long life to live ahead. She should have a preserved vision for a lifelong time and strong family history. So I would also like to treat, as Dr. Sunita said, of course, close follow-up. I would have taken a call on close follow-up if her pressures had been less than 25.
So and here again, one risk factor is myopia. So she is myopic, strong family history, pressures are 28. And discs are large. Cupping is also although it is symmetrical,
it's normal.
But in India, actually, you can't even rely on the compliance of the patient whether she is going to come for follow-up or not. Dr. Shalini's point is also valid, but in that case, if you want to keep the patient on close follow-up, you need to emphasize it again and again that she has to come every 3 to 4 months follow-up, and there is a strong risk of her developing glaucoma in near future, and she has a long life to live. She is myopic. Although I'm surprised, like in myopia, the corneal thickness is pretty okay in her. Yeah. And if the corneal thickness was less than 500, definitely treatment should have been started in this particular patient.
If you see, this patient falls in this criteria where the intraocular pressure is between 25 and 30, the central corneal thickness is between 500 and 580. There is family history of glaucoma, which is positive, and exactly the panelists have also contributed, and their opinion is absolutely like this: observe closely or treat depending on the age, myopia, and patient anxiety. Here, the patient's mother was up in arms. She didn't want even another pressure reading. She said, start treatment here and now. I have lost one eye. I don't want my daughter to do that. So that's why I checked her 3 times. On all 3 times, the pressures were in the same range, 26, 27. Of course, never above 28. But because they were so anxious, I have started treatment. So this is exactly that. Here, some would opine that observe closely. Some would opine treat. And here it's like there's age, myopia, and more importantly, the patient's mother. She said treat now.
So
we have started treatment.
So once the family members, they are so adamant, then obviously we need to start.
So exactly.
We cannot put them on risk.
You will not have a consensus. That is what I want to tell the audience, that you will not have a consensus here. So, but emphasize, as Dr. Shalini has said, follow up, follow up, follow up. Mm-hmm. I mean, you have to drill it into their heads that they have to follow up regularly. With subsequent cases, we'll decide how often. If I have not treated, how often should I do a disc? Just a quick opinion on that. How often would you do the disc photographs?
Never before 4 months. I will do around 4 to 6 months.
4 to 6 months, you'll take a disc photograph. Repeat perimetry maybe once a year or once in 6 months?
Once in 6 months.
So a very, she has a high risk characteristics. So if you observe, you have to see her every 6 months, maybe pressure every 3 months at different times of the day. So diurnal can be done in these two ways. Either you check pressure at different times of the day, morning, evening, or you actually admit the patient from 6 o'clock in the morning and you check pressure 3 hours. So that you do depending on your convenience. So this is the first case. Now we come to us.
I think in this particular patient, I would like to comment. I have seen patients like this who have strong family history, and she may be a potential, you know, candidate for juvenile open-angle glaucoma. And you never in juvenile glaucoma, open-angle glaucoma, juvenile glaucoma, there's sudden, you know, episodic rise of very high pressures which can damage the disc very fast. I have seen, and the progression of visual field damage is also pretty fast in some patients with juvenile open angle, because the pressures are in the range of 40-50.
Yeah, so
I think you need to tell the patient, and although the parents
this
are very
patient doesn't need telling, she'll come every month if
yeah,
you
yeah,
want, you
know,
that's
know.
What but yes
so
you have
yeah
to
so not more than 3 months follow up, like they should come every 3 months.
Yes, that's what it is.
One more thing I would like to add in this patient, the disc, what we saw, the vertical CD ratio seemed to be more, so it is a sort of precipitating factor for development of future glaucometer changes also. So taking into consideration that factor also, I would like to treat.
So I have started treatment, and she comes for follow-up once in 3 months. Now it's been 4 years since she's been started on treatment. Now we come to the next case. It's a 62-year-old gentleman, again came for a routine checkup. Vision was 6.6 and 5 on refraction. And pressures were 25 and 26. And of course, when the pressures were a little high, I did a central corneal thickness. So it was a little, not little, but it was low. They are thin corneas, 451, 458. And there is no history of any refractive surgery done, nothing. And family history of glaucoma is negative. So here, of course, I did, disc is fine. This is the right disc, and this is the left disc. These are the fields of the right eye. These are the fields of the left eye. This is the OCT. Now, one thing I wanted to, the OCT here, it shows a little thinning. But if you see the nerve fiber layer, it looks quite all right. Not real, so I can't really rely on this as a negative OCT, label this as perimetrometric glaucoma. No, that's one point in, one reason why I put this case is because there are many patients we see in our day-to-day life where disc is normal, fields are normal, and because pressures are a little high, OCT is abnormal, they are labeled as preperimetric glaucoma. So if your disc does not show any glaucometer's damage, you should take the OCT with a pinch of salt. That is one aspect which I wanted to cover. Of course, our panelists will, and now, so is there any formula for getting corrected IOP? Many people I have seen in the records, IOP 21, corrected IOP plus 3, 24. So this is one myth which I wanted to dispel. Do we currently have any normogram to get a formula for corrected IOP?
No, there is no
normogram. So it's a myth. There is no real normogram. You cannot add plus 3, you cannot add plus 4. All you need to do is probably keep in mind this cornea is thin. So the intraocular pressure which you are getting is actually going to be higher than what you are measuring. So this is all that you need to keep in mind. You cannot add, this is because day in and day out I see, when I see the old records of the patient, plus 21 corrected IOP plus 24. That's, we don't have any normogram. That's what the panelists also agree with me. Should I start treatment? Should I recheck IOP? And if at all, yes, how? Diurnal variation. Now in this person, he's a 62-year-old with 25-26 IOP and a thin cornea. How would you proceed?
Again, I would like to go for diurnal variation.
You will do a diurnal, yes.
And because rest of the things we can see are normal except
yes.
a bit of OCT issue.
Yes.
So I would like to follow this patient because pressure is just 25 and 26 and there are no other risk factors also. So I would like to follow up.
You would follow up.
Yeah.
But I just go back to the disc pictures.
This is the left.
So I can see some superior rim thinning just in the left eye.
One moment.
you see the vessels are not, if you see the emergence of exit of vessels, I can see some vertical elongation of cup.
Actually, it wasn't really seen.
In this picture.
Yeah, that's right.
And so just go back to the left side OCT. I think there's some loss of hourglass pattern also in the left eye. And if you see the fields also, I'm not saying, I don't know this, just go back to the fields. There are some inferior nasal defects seen here in the left eye.
Here, you know, there is a lot of, there's a little, just false.
This is left eye, this is
left eye.
Yeah,
this is the right eye, and this is
the left
eye.
If you see nasal step, although this is, I don't know whether it is the second field or the first field.
The first field.
But all these findings, if you see, are correlating, if they are reliable.
Mm-hmm.
And the pressures, corneas are thin,
yes.
Pressures are 25, 26, and you don't know the diurnal, how much is the maximum. So you have to investigate it, the patient further before labeling it as normal.
Normal or even glaucoma.
Glaucoma. So you have to, because first time investigations are showing some clues that he has some changes in the disc, in the OCT. Go back to the OCT of the left eye. If you compare both eyes, there is some loss of hourglass pattern superiorly. Yeah, here. Superiorly,
here
there is
what
some.
You're talking?
This. So in the, and okay. Then superior rim thinning. So I would like to
redo the investigations
once more.
I did the fields again, and these defects, they disappeared completely.
Yeah. So
because they were the first, exactly. Yeah. So typically, this patient would have come with labeled glaucoma, treated glaucoma, and it would have been going around in 10 places with the diagnosis.
Yeah.
So all we need to emphasize is one investigation. You're not compelled to start treatment. You can observe the patient, you can counsel the patient that you have a high risk factor. So now we have addressed this, that should I start treatment? All of you agree that I should start treatment or I should not start treatment?
We need to observe.
So this patient, we can very safely observe. He's not showing any disc damage. Recheck IOP, yes. So Dr. Shalini would say diurnal variation.
Yes.
All of you agree that there should be a diurnal variation done. How do you do a diurnal variation? If you can, Dr. Kate, if you can, or any of you, yes.
See, the ideal one is the 24-hour diurnal variation, but that is not practically feasible. So what I personally do is I call the patient on different days at different time and record the pressure. So that is a sort of modified diurnal variation test, and accordingly we get the interpretation of whether the pressure range is, the variation is less than 8 or more than 8.
So this is what I did. I didn't do a diurnal. The patient was not really willing. So I called him. I have called him at different times of the day. Once at, say, 9 o'clock, once at 12. And all the times his ranges have between 25 and 27 have never gone above that. And he's perfectly happy with now. So how I did a diurnal variation. And now this is, again, it comes, we see our algorithm. So where is the patient? The IOP is between 25 and 30. The thickness is less than 500. Family history of glaucoma is negative. So all the panelists, they agree with me that we should observe very closely. And this is exactly what we have done, that we are observing the patient. I have not started on treatment. So the patient in the normogram fits here. If there was added patient anxiety, anything, then maybe we can change it. But this gives you a brief, a quick look that this is where you will fit this patient. So these are two cases which fit into our algorithm in a different sort of a way. The next three cases will be presented by, so this is what I've done. IOP check every 3 months after doing the initial intraocular pressure measurement. Fields I'm going to do every 6 months. And OCT and photographs I'm going to repeat every year. This is the way, because it's not a very high risk, this is the way I'm going to observe. If it's a high risk, you will do disc and fields and other things much earlier, maybe every 6 months. So that you can vary. And with this, I finish my two talks. Thank you so much for a very patient listening. And now I have Dr. Kate.
Good morning, everyone. Thank you, Preeti. She has presented wonderful
nice
cases, and we had a nice discussion also.
We were only discussing. It was nice. Yeah, yeah. We were only discussing.
See, this was a 54 years old male patient. There was no family history of glaucoma. Best corrected vision 66N6. Pressure right eye 26, left eye 25. CCT right eye 568 millimicrons, left eye 578 millimicrons. Diurnal variation was less than 8. Angles were open. These were the disc changes. There were no disc changes. Discs were absolutely normal. This is HRT of the patient. Both eyes normal. Perimetry absolutely normal. So in a nutshell, this patient had a CCT corrected IOP of 21 to 25 range. As we have just now discussed, there is no universally accepted algorithm or universally accepted formula for correcting the pressure according to the CCT. But on a rough side, I usually consider 540 millimicrons as normal, and then I add plus one or deduct minus one for thicker or thinner cornea. So accordingly, this range was in 21 to 25. There was no family history. I would request the panelists to give their opinion. Dr. Shalini.
So in this particular case where we see intraocular pressure of 21 to 25, discs are absolutely normal with normal fields and normal HRT. So it is actually a case of open angles where everything else is normal except IOP. So it is always advisable to wait in such a case and observe these patients. And Dalner, you also said it was normal.
Yeah, it was
so normal. Obviously we'll wait and observe this particular patient.
Any other difference in the opinion of the panelists? So it's a clear-cut indication that such cases need observation. Don't be in a hurry to treat these cases. Keep them under observation. And we also did the same. Now, yes, that's what I'm saying. It is not universally accepted. We can just decide on the basis of thicker or thinner cornea. But if we correct, taking into consideration a particular parameter, then also this range is coming in the 21 to 25 range only.
See, there is no nomogram, but if the corneal thickness is less than 500 or more than 600, so between 500 and 600, it is more or less considered normal, and you may not adjust, but there are some formulas wherein for every 20 microns, you can add or deduct 1 millimeter. Yeah, so, no, there's nothing. So ideally, one should not write.
We actually put it just to inform that there is something like we can do it this way, but there is nothing universal regarding it. So we can just consider thick or thin cornea.
So CCT, like thinner corneas itself, are a risk factor for glaucoma development. If the cornea is thin, it's a risk factor in itself.
In fact, a few of the glaucoma specialists are doing like that. Huh. They just write thinner cornea and thicker cornea on the top of the prescription. So that if thinner cornea is there, next time they make sure that yes, this patient is at more risk. So we need to observe this particular patient more closely.
So from my presentations, we can have a take home message that this prescription should be avoided. CCT corrected IOP. I wrote it deliberately so as to give this message only. We have to avoid this. Now in the algorithm, this patient fits into ocular hypertension, pressure between 21 to 25, variation less than 8, so you have to observe this patient. Now this was another patient, 40 years old male patient, best corrected vision 66N6, family history of glaucoma positive, pressures right eye 29, left eye 27, diurnal variation was less than 8, CCT was almost in the normal range, gonioscopy open. This was the disc of the patient with the red film photographs also. Perimetry was almost normal. And this was the OCT, which was showing bit of changes. But these tests, they were the first time done tests. So young anxious patient, positive family history with these parameters. What is the panelist's opinion regarding the treatment or observation in this patient?
I think again this patient, as we have already discussed previously, the pressures are pretty high, 29, although corneal thickness is okay in this.
It is almost okay.
Mm-hmm. Positive family history, we have again discussed that the family history positive is very, very important. And if you again, you must have seen the patient, but looking at the pictures, the discs are not completely looking all right, and OCT is also, I don't know, you may have seen
what I'm saying is from that side we are seeing little
little from this side we are seeing some changes
also. I had seen you just come to the front, X-ray is absolutely normal,
so no, I go by your point that the disc is normal, but OCT I'll say you're saying first time, so first time and second time it doesn't matter, the signal strength should be all right. Even the first time, if it is more than in Cirrus, if it is more than 6 or 7, then it can be considered as, in fields there's a learning curve, but in OCT the signal strength is important. So I don't know about the signal strength, but again I'll consider this patient as very, very, you know,
high
risk patient. And maybe since it is 29, you have done the diurnal?
Yeah, yeah.
So diurnal maximum is?
No, diurnal was less than 8 actually.
No, less than 8, but maximum pressure is 29.
Yes, 29.
So 29 in itself is a risk, because when it is more than 28, 29, there is a risk of vascular occlusions, especially in older patients. This is a young patient. But if the patient is hypertensive also and the pressures are 29, 30, then there is risk of ocular vascular occlusions, CRVO and all. So definitely if the pressure is 29-30, there is in itself indication to treat the patient.
And strong family history.
And strong family history.
Moreover, if we see the OCT reports, the right eye is definitely showing changes. Here we can see very clearly. And the pressure is also high in the right eye only. So I would also like to treat this particular patient.
So this is a sort of pre-perimetric glaucoma rather than clear-cut ocular hypertension.
So one thing I just wanted to emphasize that I had a similar patient, but his pressures were 32. He had gone to, over the period of 5 years, he had visited 7 different ophthalmologists and all had recorded pressures as 32-34. He was not on treatment. Every time he would do fields, and for 7 years with pressures of 32 and 34, the fields were normal, OCT was normal, not progressing. But yet we should opt to treat, not from the glaucoma point of view, but from the risk of vascular occlusion. So the vascular occlusions are extremely high if their pressures are uncontrolled. So it is from that point of view also that you should treat pressures which are higher. This is just one point I wanted to emphasize.
So in algorithm it is clearly written if the pressure is more than 30, the patient should be treated.
Yes. So he was a young anxious patient with positive family history, and our decision was also to treat, and we treated the patient with on a medical line only. There is another option of treating the patient with SLT also, but that is the second option. If at all we are starting treatment in ocular hypertension, it is the medical line of treatment only. So in this algorithm, where does this patient fit? The pressures were 25 to 30, CCT 500 to 580, family history of glaucoma positive. There are two options, either observe closely or treat. We opted for treatment because he was a young patient and he was an anxious patient. So these patients need to be started on treatment. Any other opinion? Madam Rita Dhamankar is also here. We would like to have her opinions also. You didn't see this case.
Maybe third case.
Third case we will discuss. So this is another patient, 47 years old female patient, history of radial keratotomy, best corrected visual acuity, right eye plus 2.25, spherical with plus 1.5 cylinder, 110 degree 6-6. Left eye plus 3.75 diopter, spherical 6-6. Pressures were right eye 28, left eye 35. Diurnal variation was more than 8. CCT right eye was thick, 615. Left eye 612. Angles were open. These were the disc photographs. She is a high myope patient. So discs are never absolutely reliable. I mean, you can't decide on the basis of disc appearance. Perimetry, little bit peripheral scotomas, but I don't think very much significant. This was the OCT. So pressure 28 to 35, thick cornea, variation more than 8, history of RK, what to do in this case?
Now in this particular case, I feel it should not be guided by thick cornea, because cornea might be fibrosed in such patients after RK, and it may give a variable readings of corneal thickness. But because pressure is so high, 35 in the other eye, and with diurnal variation of more than 8, and especially myope being already a risk factor of glaucoma, I think we should treat this particular patient.
Madam Dr. Rita Dhamankar.
That it's very difficult to take a call by looking at the disc alone, where you want to take a call of whether to treat or not to treat in case of a high myo, because the disc can be pretty misleading. The other thing that I would actually like to also highlight is that yes, post RK you can get a lot of fibrosis, but then the fibrosis is also more central because you don't go too peripherally and you don't want to, especially in the older days when they used to do RK, they used to make sure that their central their peripheral cuts were deeper than their central cuts actually. So I don't know how much the fibrosis comes into the center to affect the corneal thickness, but therefore we always say that when you're doing a refractive surgery, it is much better to check on the corneal thickness before you do the refractive procedure. That helps. That is a very good guideline to take us further. But with pressures of 35 at any case, whether you have anything or you don't have anything, I think it's a very good idea to treat. There is no question about not treating such a patient, because at whatever point in time, all patients who have pressures more than 28 do convert to glaucoma. The chances of them converting to glaucoma in 5 years is 50%. So why would you want to take such a chance?
Exactly. The corneal biomechanics will be altered. And how those altered corneal biomechanics will translate into intraocular pressure, we don't have too many studies. But we know that they are altered. And here the pressures are so high. So, I mean, 35, you would want to start treatment.
Yeah, so I think everyone's opinion is that if the pressure is more than 28, I think the patient should be started on treatment. And this particular patient was myopic. That is one risk factor. Then family history, another risk factor, and the pressures are too. So there's no doubt about not treating this patient, this particular patient.
No, I think it was negative.
It's negative.
Family history is not positive.
Yeah.
I have not mentioned, sorry, but family history was negative in this case. That risk factor was not there.
But one should not go by OCT findings in patients with high myopes.
Yes, that's what
because
I
here
was
it is showing lot of changes.
Yes,
and it could be because of the no, and you see there's a lot of artifacts there, that black things. So this is not that is not image. And
so
what is the signal strength? So one should see before reading the printout that it is like it is done correctly. There are no artifacts. The signal strength is normal.
So the OCT was done in the normal pressure range only after bringing down the pressure. So the basic thing was, I wanted to emphasize that in high myopic patients, your OCT is not that reliable.
No, and one more thing. Here we are trying to say, should you treat or not? So most of the cases I showed was without treatment on the initial thing. On initial assessment, should you treat or should you not?
Okay. So now about the role of corneal biomechanics. In such cases, how does corneal biomechanics affect your pressure reading? Dr. Shalini or Dr. Sunita? Corneal hysteresis and all. How is it going to affect the post-RK or any post-refractive surgery cases?
See, I would say more than RK, now we should look about LASIK and the SMILE and other things which we see more commonly.
So any post-refractive surgery.
Exactly. See, post-refractive surgery, again, we don't know how it affects, because it not only changes the corneal thickness, it also changes other corneal biomechanics like, say, rigidity and other factors. So all we need to, like all patients who potentially want to undergo LASIK and they come to the clinic for an opinion, or those who have come to the clinic after doing LASIK, what I tell them is, if you are going to undergo LASIK, I'll give you all your records, your intraocular pressure, the thickness, a good disc photograph, and an OCT, because these are myopes. These are at high risk of developing glaucoma anyways. They may not develop glaucoma now. They will develop glaucoma maybe 40, maybe 20, maybe 30 years later. But they should have some baseline. Now, why I don't think of OCT as a baseline is that we have from stratus to serous, you cannot compare. So whatever you have after 20 years, you are not going to be able to compare. But a good disc photograph is always comparable. So I would say, as terms of intraocular pressure, we have no normogram again. Only we have to know this cornea is thin,
the intraocular pressure will be underestimated. So those who have come with LASIK, I have checked, always the intraocular pressures are lower. But if I have tried to correlate what is the residual corneal thickness to the pressure, I have failed to reach any normogram. So I know that yes, the pressure will be thinner. You tell the patient the pressure is going to be thinner for the rest of his life. The pressure is going to be lower for the rest of his life. So that way you counsel them. And as I said, intraocular pressure, I failed to find any normogram. But take a good disc photograph for all of those who want to undergo LASIK and tell them to preserve their data for at least 20, 30 years.
I think she's absolutely right. The other question, she has described everything very well. Which tonometer to use in such cases? Because applanation, especially after LASIK, may not be very reliable. It gets affected by the corneal thickness and corneal biomechanics. So exactly what tonometer you are going to use, which is, you can't have everything like dynamic contour, tonometer and all, but out of the tonometers which are available to you, which one can you use? You can use Tonopen because it, or maybe eye care is also it gets affected by the corneal thickness, but Tonopen, since the applanation area is very small, you can do it in the periphery also, or you know, in the center in case of RK. So I think, because we don't have any nomogram for corneal biomechanics as well. And as she rightly said, before doing any refractive surgery, one should have complete glaucoma workup of a patient, including disc photograph. But again, in cases of high myopia, disc may not be, because it may look glaucomatous, large disc with shallow cup. So field, I think field evaluation is one of the most important investigation, which will be reliable and can be repeated. OCT will not again be reliable. So I will go by field evaluation if I suspect glaucoma in such cases on a regular basis.
So I think in such cases, don't get carried away with the thick cornea. Whatever thick cornea you are getting, it is not actually thick. You have to adjust for the corneal hysteresis part also, and you have to consider the case comprehensively. Okay. So in our algorithm, where does this case fit? It is pressure more than 30, you have to treat. You don't have to consider other risk factors also. Any pressure more than 30, go for treatment. So at the end, I would like to go for a few tips regarding ocular hypertension. As we initially described, ocular hypertension is something where pressure is more than 21, disc normal, fields normal, angle open, and absence of any other ocular disease is there. Important risk factors are family history, older age, high myopia, and race. African Americans, they are more prone for it. A patient with ocular hypertension undergoes all the investigations that a patient with glaucoma would. Reduce the pressure by 20 to 25% from baseline. Stable ocular hypertensive patient should be examined at 3 to 6 month intervals. Individualization of the therapy is the key, as we have been discussing during this whole course. Different cases, different approach, different parameters, you have to approach differently. It is never universal. You have to approach the patient depending upon the different risk factors and different parameters. So individualization of therapy is the key. Observations for patients at relatively low risk. Treatment as a means of risk reduction for those at high risk of converting to glaucoma. And there is a risk calculator as well. It was developed after pooling data from OATS and European Glaucoma Prevention Study. It is available online. It can help guide clinical management decisions for OATS patients. It is not necessary to use a risk calculator in all, but it can just guide you as to what to do in these cases of ocular hypertension. Different variables are considered in this risk calculator. Age, increasing age puts the patient to more of risk of ocular hypertension. Mean intraocular pressure, if it is a high pressure, the patient is at a higher risk for developing glaucoma. CCT, as we have been discussing during the course, thinner corneas, more prone to develop glaucoma. Mean vertical CD ratio by contour, this was also considered in this risk calculator. So more is the vertical CD ratio, more is the risk for developing glaucoma. And mean pattern standard deviation on perimetry. So if it is more than or equal to 2.8, then the patient is on a higher risk to developing glaucoma. So when we sum up all these points, then in this risk calculator, if the patient gets the points of 0 to 6, that is a low risk, observation is recommended every 6 months, 7 to 12, that is an intermediate risk, counseling recommended on risk or benefits of treatment versus close observation. And more than 12, that is a high risk, initiation of treatment is recommended. So here I finish with this. We would like to invite questions from the audience also, which panelists would be happy to answer and share the opinions.
Comment that here your last case had some risk factors like high myopia and other stuff, and because the pressures are more than 30 and thick corneas we did not take into consideration because they were sort of modified by her refractive surgery. Mm-hmm. But there have been studies where the corneas have been thick. It's a subset of Oates patients only. No, it's a separate study that thick corneas, little high pressures, and they were just observed. And it's like this. And they most of them, they went on to develop glaucoma. So even if the patient is absolutely normal, in the sense, is not a myope, has no family history, and if you decide to observe, because the corneas are very thick, but if the pressures are higher, their conversion to glaucoma is very, very high. So that is why you have to very closely follow up these patients also. Now, there are some recommendations where you follow up once in 2 years. Do you actually do that once in 2 years?
No.
No.
Yeah, exactly. Not at all. Mm-hmm. In fact, if the patient is high risk, I keep following within 6 months only. And if I don't find any risk factor, I prefer following it 1 year.
Actually, in fact, there was an extension of Oates study. So they followed up the patient for 7 years more after 5 years. And they found that the conversion from ocular hypertension to POAG is very less in low risk patients, whereas it was high in patients with high risk. So take home message is you would like to treat only when the patient is having high risk of development of glaucoma, like myope, family history, thin CCT. So these are the risk factors. If there is no risk factor present and the pressure is again a risk factor, more than 28, there are 7 times more risk of developing glaucoma. So intraocular pressure, thin CCT, family history, myopia. So these are the risk factors. But if the patient is not having any of these risk factors, if the pressure is less than 28 and there's no other risk factor, then the patient falls under the category of low risk. And you may not like to treat that patient. And that patient, the likelihood of development of glaucoma is very, very less. So I think the take-home message is to treat ocular hypertensive patients only when the pressure is beyond a certain range, like that beyond 28, there is risk factors. Family history is a strong risk factor, myopia, thin CCT. So I think that is the take-home message.
In risk factor cases, you have to treat even if the pressure is less than 28.
And one more thing is that do not start treatment. What we see in pressure in our practice is do not start treatment on one single reading. You have to check the pressure, even if it's a high risk. You cannot start treatment on one single reading. That is what I want to emphasize, because we see that many times in practice. And plus, can you just address NCT? And because many times
I wanted
26, 28 NCT,
exactly.
Start treatment.
Yes.
Follow up also on NCT. That way.
So
yeah.
That is
a
very
problem
we encounter.
Very common practice to start treatment on NCT. And NCT, in fact, gives slightly higher reading, especially when patient is squeezing eye and not cooperating well. So in that case, we always need to confirm our readings with applanation only. And in fact, many people at periphery are still using Schiotts and doing IOP on Schiotts and starting treatment on Schiotts. Same holds true for it also, that we should always start treatment after confirming our reading with applanation. And sterilization is also an important issue because it is a contact procedure. So always clean your prism while you are shifting to another patient, and then still a drop of antibiotic after completing the procedure.
So you give antibiotics to every patient who one drop of antibiotic?
One drop, yes, after completing the procedure.
Any questions from the audience? One thing I felt was putting antibiotic, you're actually increasing the risk of resistance. So it's not required.
Like just put a lubricant after taking pressure.
Yes, and one more thing that those who give intravitreal injections also. Now there are studies which say now these intravitreals need to be given say every 3 weeks or every month. So in them they have said that if you give topical antibiotics, you're increasing the resistance. Mm-hmm. So even people have stopped giving pre-op antibiotics drops for intravitreal injections also.
Actually,
post-procedure antibiotic drops we usually give now.
That is any procedure, I think the prophylaxis is done by betadine. Antibiotic, it's controversial whether you should actually give antibiotics. So I think that's a different topic altogether. But after taking pressure, use of antibiotic is not essential. Anyway, you have to disinfect the tonometer.
Yes,
and maybe you can just put a drop of lubricant after that.
So I think here we come to the end of this session. I would like to thank our panelists, Dr. Sunita Dubey, Dr. Shalini Mohan. And I would like to thank the audience also who happened to be here in the early morning breakfast session. Thank you so much.
Oh, that I happened to me yesterday. Now I know all the halls.
I know G. I was also under the impression.